The views expressed on this program are those of the producers and individuals appearing on this program and do not necessarily reflect the views of the Sun Prairie Media Center staff, its video service providers, or the staff and elected officials of the City of Sun Prairie.
Hello and welcome to Real Reviews. My name is Jameson Rabbit, and the man joining me this week is the former bassist in a Toto cover band. His name is Mike Roth.
I bless the rains in Africa.
Do you?
Yeah. That's. Have you ever noticed there's no vampires there?
In Africa?
Mm-hmm. That's reason.
I have noticed that.
To Toto, bless the rains, mm-hmm. and every time they go outside, I mean, they're not even safe.
That's holy rain.
Night.
That's holy water coming
yep.
down.
Just sizzle away. That's how you get your vampires under control.
I never put two and two together, and I still don't think I have. But I will take it, sir. This week, we have some big movies, some big actors.
Ones that were supposed to be in the theaters.
People I've heard of. Mm-hmm. This is going to be a good time. So let's jump into what we have for you this week. And I'm going to get us started with a film that was originally set to be in theaters and then was moved over to the new Apple TV service. It's kind of been a boon for them. And I'm talking about Greyhound. This is from director Aaron Schneider. This stars Tom Hanks as Captain Krause. Captain Krause, this is set during World War II. He and his destroyer are tasked with shepherding an Allied convoy across the North Atlantic, which at this time is teeming with German U-boats. Just Nazi submarines everywhere you look. And it is Captain Krause's first time out doing this. He's never done this type of mission, and you can feel the uneasiness early on as he boards, and all of these young men are looking to him. He has his number one, Stephen Graham plays Charlie Cole, which is kind of his bossing mate, who kind of carries out all his orders. But it is basically a film that takes place on the seas the entire movie, and it's pretty much start to finish the tension of where's the U-boat now?
Mm-hmm.
There's very little breaks for you, the watcher, or for Captain Krause himself. Like, there's no rest. There's no time to relax because, ahoy, there's another one.
And they show that, too. There's, like, a scene where his feet start bleeding because he's been wearing the same shoes for a long time. And as much as I want to sympathize with him, I'm thinking, what about everybody else who's running around and actually, I mean, don't think anybody slept for 2 days.
No, and you see that the guy who's working in the kitchen in the galley keeps trying to bring food to him, and that just gets set aside.
Yeah.
Like, no time for that, no time to eat. I think that the strengths of this film are obviously Tom Hanks.
Oh, yeah.
Right? I mean, he's just great in this. And I like how tight the script is. Like, there's no Hollywood melodrama to this movie.
No.
You know, there's no, like, drama aboard the boat. This guy is actually, you know, doing something. Like, none of that. It's pretty straightforward. We're telling this story. We're building the tension.
I actually would have liked a little bit more drama.
Yeah.
When I was all done with this, and this is shot beautifully, looks great. Tom Hanks makes any movie better. It's kind of like salt on food in general.
Right.
And Tom Hanks just tops it. But most of this movie, if not all of this movie, is just tactical maneuvers.
Right.
There is some tension where you have, like, the Nazis getting on their speaker and they're taunting them. And you have that, you know, Jaws-like feeling, like it's underwater. I can't see it, but I know it's there and it wants to kill me. But I didn't get really any story besides tactical maneuvers. I would like to have seen Tom Hanks's relationship a little bit more, relationship with the crew, or
I think it's part of those that he didn't really have a relationship with the crew. He was just kind of on the boat for the first time, it seemed like to me. I love the use of that terminology and the technology from the 1940s, and that kind of controlled chaos aboard the boat as you're running. He's running from one side to the other. People, you know, the sonar guy is trying to pick things up, and there's just kind of this heightened battle as they're trying to track these subs. And how excited the guys on the guns were getting just anytime they had a chance to fire away, even if they're shooting at one of their own while they're doing it.
There is one kid's helmet that really bugged me.
Yeah, I know. It reminded me of the Death Star gunner helmets.
Yeah.
That's what I thought of the whole time.
I wasn't sure if that was supposed to be, well, you know, supplies were, you know, scarce, so they had to take what they had. But there's a lot other people with bigger heads that would have fit
that
helmet.
The kid had a big helmet.
He had a huge helmet.
I do like that. I mean, it's the strength of Tom Hanks is that you feel the loss that he feels when one of his ships goes down. You feel the responsibility because these are ships that are carrying supplies to help win other battles.
Yeah.
And you feel it. Classic Tom Hanks just in the eyes acting of like, oh, I've let it down.
In a way, it's also an underdog story, too, because this was his first ship going from the East Coast to Germany. He was in Pearl Harbor before, but everybody was praising him for being a master at doing this, and it was his first run. So you have that kind of underdog story, too. That's kind of fun.
Yeah. You know, Tom Hanks has done other boat movies in the past. We've had him out there.
He's been a captain 6 times.
Is he really?
Yes, if you include the captain of the shrimp boat, 6 times.
He's had Tragedy on Water. I'll point to Joe versus the Volcano.
Apollo 13, Saving Private Ryan, Captain Phillips, Sully, Forrest Gump.
Yeah, that's true.
So he plays Captain Awesome.
He's very good. I actually heard him on a podcast this week leading up to this, and he talked about, because he also has been in a lot of World War II films and projects. And he says, oh, yeah, I fully believe that in my twilight years of my life, I'll believe that I served in World War II. My kids will take me to Normandy, and I'll show them where I stormed the beach. he's on board with it. I don't think this is, like, one of his war epics. We've seen many, many better Tom Hanks films. Yeah. I think it's enjoyable. I like the tension of it. It's not even as good as, like, Captain Phillips, I don't think.
No.
But I still enjoyed this.
I liked it, too. I just wanted something different, and it just felt, even though Tom Hanks is great and it was shot nice, I wanted something more than just, I wanted to feel something more.
What did you give Greyhound, sir?
I gave it a 3. It is a good movie. I didn't think it was out of the ballpark, though.
Yeah, I gave it 3.5. It's an enjoyable film, and massive for Apple TV
to
get
huge
eyeballs on this. They set records for how many subscriptions they got.
You have to do something between those Star Wars runs.
You do. All right, next, sir, let's move to Hulu, where we had another movie that was supposed to be in theaters originally, I believe.
This is Palm Springs, directed by Matt Barbaco. I'm going to go with it. Or Barbacow.
Whatever.
We're going to go with it. Adam Samberg, he plays Niles. He's this nihilistic kind of jerk at this wedding in Palm Springs. He goes around. He seems to be really great at everything he does. And he gets familiar with kind of a person who's kind of offset from the rest of the crowd of the party, Sarah. What ends up happening is she finds out through a weird situation, very surreal, that he went through a time loop and he's been doing this day over and over and over again, very much like Groundhog's Day or Happy Death Day or a lot of other
Live,
movies.
Live, Die, Repeat, or whatever you want to call that.
As far as I know, this is the first one where it was two people kind of stuck together.
Yeah.
Three, if you count J.K. Simmons.
J.K. Simmons is Roy.
Who is always fantastic, no matter what.
Yeah.
This is hilarious. I really enjoyed a lot of this film. It really doesn't do anything new, and I am a sucker for this time continuum type movies, but I love how Adam Samberg and Kristen
Milotti. Yeah.
I like their chemistry.
Yeah.
I like their relationship. I thought it felt pretty true. Like, once they become honest, you know, she kind of leaves them in the lurch for many, many, many days.
I think it's interesting because the movie opens basically with you don't know how long Samberg's been in this loop, how long Niles has been in this loop, living the same day, every day. The monotony is set in. And so he's just trying to entertain himself in whatever way he can, but he's just drinking hard. And so when Sarah ends up basically following him into the portal, getting caught in this time loop, and she's trapped there with him, I like how it plays out where you go from dreading that wake up every morning, the same wake up, the same life over and over and uh-huh. over, to suddenly there's some excitement. There's somebody else in this with you now.
Yeah.
And suddenly there's someone you can share this life with. And you can, you, when he shows her how to just accept it mm-hmm. and just go with it, and then you get to live every day suddenly with someone who you care about, mm-hmm. who you have fun with. Suddenly the consequences don't matter. So let's just go be crazy and there's just have some fun. And, you know, sure, occasionally there's a guy who's going to show up who wants to hunt you. Mm-hmm. You know, that happens.
Which was the first person you were like, yeah, this is the greatest day ever. Let's do this every day. And yeah. then the person you drag in regrets it and tries to murder you. Well, actually murders you.
Well, and then you also have the flip side then of like, okay, but you have it. You have somebody in there that you're having fun with, that you enjoy, that you love, whatever. Mm-hmm. But is there any meaning to it anymore then?
And
you know, and that's the question. Is, yeah. is there meaning? And of course, love isn't easy. Even in a time loop, love is never easy.
No.
And the drawback to this is that even though death doesn't mean anything, death has no grip over you, mm-hmm. pain still is real. And so heartache and regret, living an eternity with that,
yeah.
that's painful.
And I was very interested in if this relationship was going to go any further because of that. You know, an eternity with only one person. It's essentially the last two people on Earth scenario.
Pretty much, yeah.
Everybody, you have tons of people in this Earth, but they don't know what you know, and they are going to be gone and forgotten pretty much the next day. Mm-hmm. Anything you do has no consequences right. at all, except for with one person. So that, I thought, put an interesting spin yep. on doing a whole day over and over and over again for an eternity. I thought that was creative. Some of my problems with it.
Yeah.
Adam Samberg was just too good at everything. And
he's had an eternity to do it.
He did, but there's some situations you knew were unique, and he, you know, he'd throw something over his shoulder and he hit the garbage can. And
yeah.
it's like, well, that's possible, but I mean.
He's had 7,000 tries at that. here's one of the things. So I enjoyed this movie. I ended up rewatching this
yeah.
movie. And, there were some little throwaway lines that I didn't pick up the first time because it was earlier in the movie.
Uh-huh.
I didn't know like what was going to happen. So when I rewatch it, there's a couple of times where people mention like, you know, like, oh, which, you know, you only get that one. Well, they get that opportunity once. And he's like, uh-huh. you wouldn't even know. Or at one point, one of the older ladies, I don't remember if it was his mom, somebody comes up to him like,
uh-huh.
I've been to more weddings than you could ever dream of. And he's like, you have no idea. I've been to the same wedding a million times.
Mm-hmm.
I kind of like that. Look, I am a huge Andy Samberg fan, outside of one movie. Everything else he's done, I've okay. loved. He did that one with Adam Sandler early on, That's My Boy, which was just a terrible movie. But outside of that, I think Andy Samberg is really funny, and he's really smart. And when he's hooked up with his buddies in the Lonely Island group who produced this and starred in this in a little bit roles, I think he's really good. And I like their, like you said, I like their chemistry. Mm-hmm. I think it's a sweet movie. It's a funny movie.
And
J.K. Simmons is always a nice little treat in a movie.
He's like a Tom Hanks, too.
Like their first interaction mm-hmm. outside of when he first gets hit with an arrow, but
yeah.
when we flash back and they're at the bar,
uh-huh.
I mean, that was hilarious.
I even like the sweet scenes later on where it's nice and quiet and they're sitting in the backyard.
Mm-hmm.
J.K. Simmons just makes everything a little better.
And he does.
Imagine a Tom Hanks, J.K. Simmons movie.
That'd be pretty good. I don't think we've gotten that.
No, I don't know how you would combine those two personalities.
I mean, J.K. Simmons can also be very menacing.
He could be.
I mean, in Whiplash, he was menacing.
He was,
good man.
Yeah. I
good.
Love that. That's a great movie.
So Palm Springs, sir, what do you give this Hulu treat?
I give it a 4. I might have given it a 4.5. I really enjoyed this movie, but mm-hmm. I stopped at 4
yeah.
because,
just
there
because.
You go.
Yeah, I give it a 4 as well. And like I said, I ended up watching this twice in a week.
Mm-hmm.
And there's a lot there for this on the second time around, the second go around, as you know, a lot of these types of movies do. But really enjoyed it, and it's one of those that yeah I'll probably rewatch again this year.
I feel like this is going to be like one of those movies where a couple of years down the road I might say, man, I should have gave that a higher
yeah.
score. It's like the guy who didn't give Star Wars like a 5. It's like, man,
the guy who said E.T. was a
was
not
bad
for me.
Do
better.
Might have to look back on it and give bigger scores.
The next movie we have, oh by the way, before I move on from Palm Springs, this movie holds the record I meant, kind of mentioned this last week at Sundance for, you know, the movies go up for sale. Holds the record. This movie was sold for $17.5 million and 69 cents. At, the previous record was $17.5 million, so then they went 69 cents.
69 cents.
Classic.
That's classic.
Anyways, let's move on to another movie that has somebody kind of maybe caught in a time loop.
Yep.
People that death does not have a grip over. On Netflix, we have The Old Guard from director Gina Prince-Bythewood. Stars Charlize Theron as Andy, who is the leader of this team of immortals who serve as mercenaries that are protecting the mortal world. Some of these for untold number of centuries they've been doing this. I read that Charlize Theron's character is supposed to be 6,000 years old.
I believe it.
That's pretty old.
Yeah.
And they kind of, at one point, they go against their own rules and do a mission that they've already done before. And it breaks bad, and they end up getting exposed for who they are as another group is hunting them down to replicate their abilities and monetize them. Meanwhile, they also discover that there is a new lady named Nile, played by Kiki Layne, who doesn't know that she has these very same abilities, and they try to integrate her into this tight-knit team. And it doesn't always go smoothly, and this group is facing trouble from all sides. Another tidbit is that they lose their immortality at some point without warning.
Yeah.
There's no idea when it will happen, but at some point, you are not going to regenerate from your wounds, and that makes things interesting, especially when you can go from being fearless and no worries about death to suddenly, yeah, that's going to be a problem. Mm-hmm. It kind of changes how you fight, this is an interesting movie. So Charlize Theron and Kiki Layne, a lot of action in this movie, a lot of fights, especially you saw in that trailer there, them having a fight on an airplane. I thought that was a really fun scene. Mm-hmm. Really didn't use any stunt doubles. They did pretty much all their stunts together on that. You also have Matthias Schoenert as Booker, who's kind of her right-hand man on the team. And then you have a couple of guys, Joe and Nikki, who are on this team, who I really enjoyed.
I wanted more of their backstory.
Yeah, like I could stand for more of them because it's a gay couple who've been together and been through the wars, literally and figuratively, for centuries.
They were they met on a battlefield on
in the Crusades.
Opposing sides. And to go from that level of hate to love, I wanted to really know more about that.
And there's a lot of great humanity in that relationship. Even there's moments where they're in some real trouble.
Yeah.
And just looks. There's looks in the eyes where you're like, oh, they've been through stuff before.
Yeah.
Like, this is not a problem. And I really like their relationship. You also have Chiwetel Ejiofor, who's kind of on the bad side, right? He's he's helping lead the team that's trying to take these people down.
But later on, I mean, he's not really bad because
he's working with the bad guy.
Yeah, the bad guy is Merrick, who's played by Harry Melling.
Mm-hmm.
He wants to grab these people because, of course, if you could capitalize on immortality, you could end cancer and all these other things that plague Earth.
Sure.
And there's a lot of money into that.
Yeah.
And, of course, the CIA guy who really wanted to, he's kind of a bad guy, but he did it because he wants the cure for things that kill people. Where Merrick, who's bad guy, he's a sadist, he wanted the money. And he also, I think, likes the fact that he could torture things and it just doesn't die.
That guy tortured kittens as a child.
Yeah.
You can just tell.
Yeah.
I really like Kiki Layne as Nile. I like her character. I think she has a real presence on the screen.
Mm-hmm.
I like her a lot. Charlize Theron is one of my favorite actresses ever, and so I enjoy her in this. And I like I think their chemistry together works really well, too, is like the old dog realizing, like, I'm going to have to pass something on to her.
I really didn't feel it.
Really?
I felt the relationship between Joe and Nikki,
mm-hmm.
but Andy and Nile, they were separated a lot.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
It seemed to focus too much on the superhero aspect. And Greg Rucka, who wrote the screenplay and the graphic novel, mm-hmm. he says, this is not a superhero movie, but I'm not seeing anything that makes this too much different.
I mean, this
than
basically felt like Highlander to me.
Highlander or Underworld. Sure. It's the same kind of thing that we've been dealing with also Wolverine and Deadpool.
Sure.
It's nothing really too new or fantastic. The only thing that I got out of this that was really new was a more diverse cast mm-hmm. as superheroes.
Right.
But overall, this is still a superhero movie that I didn't get much difference.
See, I liked their dynamic. I felt their dynamic between the two of them. Matthias Schoenaerts is the one that who I felt like was the outlier because he's a really good actor. I really enjoy him in most things he does. And in this movie, it felt like he was the odd man out to me.
Okay.
Like they, you know, he has a turn at some point in the movie, but it didn't land for me. Felt like he was too little too late for me.
And I feel like maybe they should have expanded on a lot of these other characters.
Yeah.
And as much as I like Charlize Theron, she's fantastic. She really had her choreography down yeah. on all these moves. Yeah. It was really cool watching her fight.
She's really good at that. I mean, Atomic Blonde last year, kind of yeah. similar. Like, she's just, I'm going to do this.
But I didn't get anything different from her character. Yeah. Her character felt like a lot of other characters that I've already seen in other
sure,
movies.
That's fair. What did you give The Old Guard?
I gave it a 3. It is a good movie, and 3 might be a little low, but I'm sticking with it because I didn't get what I wanted.
Stick with it, man. Again, I gave it 3.5. I enjoyed it. Part of it is, man, it's just refreshing to see a movie with movie stars and good-looking action going on.
Uh-huh. It's been nice.
Been a rough run.
Yeah, it's really.
All right, so moving on to our Summer of Keanu. We are going to... You got a year on this one? I forgot to look.
Yes, it's 1997.
97?
Did you want to talk about it or should I talk about
it? I'll let you. This is a movie with Charlize Theron. We carry over.
Yeah, this is... You're really good at matching up these Keanu movies. Devil's Advocate is what we're talking about, directed by Taylor Hackford. Keanu Reeves, he plays Kevin Lomax. He is a hotshot Florida lawyer that gets people off that probably shouldn't be getting off.
Oh, he's never lost a case.
He's never lost a case, and it seems a little uncanny. Maybe something is working the strings a little bit. Well, he is picked up by a very prominent, wealthy man in New York who's played by Al Pacino, John Milton, and John Milton gives him a case, and of course he wins again and gives him another case, which is really tough. And Kevin has to kind of balance out his morality or the fact that he needs to win, his yeah. vanity of being the best.
He struggles with that balance.
He struggles with it, but he always goes and fails to vanity. Mm-hmm. Charlie Thurston plays his wife, who's very proud of her very brilliant husband.
Right, she's more like the down-home, like high school sweetheart. Mm-hmm. You know, like, hey, we don't have to, like, have all the money and power, right?
At first, I think she enjoyed.
Sure.
But then weird things start happening, being isolated and alone yeah. in a place that she's not familiar with. You could tell that, it makes it obvious that her mental health is deteriorating, but her husband's not home
right.
or anybody that she cares for is near her to help
like
her go through
down
this.
To this debauchery that does happen around her.
Yeah.
She starts seeing some evil around the corner.
And Al Pacino, he kind of plays with the puppet strings a little bit. This is one of my favorite Keanu Reeves movies.
Really?
You could watch this one over and over again. You pick up little lines that Al Pacino says all the time, and he's like, he's always telling you he's the devil.
Yeah, he is.
He's always telling
he
you.
He wants you to know.
But, like, when you first watch it in the theaters, you don't pick it up until, you know, closer to the end.
I really like Al Pacino in this movie. I mean, he's great. You know, he's great in this as just the guy who's offering limitless power and opportunity, and mm-hmm. he can solve any problem for you, and he's just offering anything to you. Just sell your soul to me, basically.
Yeah.
And I think he's great. And he's got one of the great monologues at the end of this movie when they're in his office and he's revealing, basically spelling it out for Kevin because Kevin just hasn't figured it out yet.
Uh-huh.
Where he's like, look, here's who I am, idiot. You know, and that's one of the great Pacino monologues. This is the first movie that I saw Charlize Theron in. Fell in love with her.
Yeah.
I mean, she's very, she hadn't done anything that I'd seen at this point. She's like 20-something years old at this when this movie came out. I think she's great. Keanu, I don't think is great in this movie. I think he is, he's wooden, and he has a really terrible Southern accent that kind of comes and goes in this movie.
But you can tell that this is, he's branching out in right. his
It's at a transition point, it feels like, in his career. Yeah. And, you know, working with Al Pacino, that's a dream come true. Mm-hmm. And, yeah, it was just a little rough. Because, I mean, Keanu isn't, like, a great actor. I don't think anyone would say, that guy's one of the best.
Yeah.
He has his niches where he's great.
Yeah.
But there's a long stretch of his career where his ability to emote was not a strong suit for him.
No. He does, like an action hero. He can do stern and serious really good. He could also play a kid really good. And in this point in his life, he's trying to transition and become more broad. And
it's a good morality story. You know, it offers some morality questions.
Yeah.
Jeffrey Jones in this movie, you know, the principal from Ferris Bueller, a real life monster. Mm-hmm. That man's the real life devil.
Yeah.
He's had some issues. I wonder what that is. Look him up. This is, you know, a buddy of mine, Josh, this is on his Mount Rushmore of favorite movies of all time.
What do you really?
Think? Yeah. Yeah, it's like his top four movies ever.
I can't see that, but I can I can see it being. I mean, it is a great movie though.
Yeah,
I would not downplay.
Yeah, it's a good time. I did not remember it being 2 hours and 25 minutes long though. Rewatched it.
Doesn't feel like it.
Like,
though.
Oh wow, I do not remember it being this long. Anyways, Keanu, we love Keanu.
Yeah, Keanu's a great guy, and you will hear more about Keanu Reeves every week,
every week
until we come to our grand finale.
Stay tuned. before we move on, of course, we want to thank our sponsor, Marcus Theaters, The Palace, here in Sun Prairie. Thank you for sponsoring this program. We do hope doors open eventually.
Yeah.
We don't want to see doors close for good. So we encourage you, if you have the app, that there's an opportunity for you to support them if you'd like.
I get more and more nervous.
Yeah. We're losing theaters here in town, and that makes me nervous.
And the theaters have been struggling before this started. Yeah. So when you can, you know, try to support.
I've been just dropping off bags of cash at the front door. I hope they've been getting it, though.
Well, you've been a loyal customer every week almost.
I'm get that popcorn, man.
You're getting that popcorn.
Gotta get that popcorn.
It's delicious popcorn. Delicious food, too. Try the pizza.
Eat the pizza.
I've been missing the pizza, and I picked up a pizza from them because
attaboy.
I like that stuff.
Well done.
And every week I had that pizza, and then it just disappeared from my life for a while.
Next week, sir, first off, I'm not going to be here. I'm not going to, you're going to be a whole different face sitting in this chair.
This is the first time I've heard about this.
Oh, no.
I don't like this.
I said, not said anything. I will be replaced by our boss, Jeff Robbins.
So my idea of setting everything on fire in protest is
still
not.
Do it? He might not be cool with that. Next week, though, for streaming things, we have things such as on Netflix, there's a film called Fatal Affair. This is Nia Long and Omar Epps in a tale of love and betrayal, I think. It's in the title. We also have on Hulu, Into the Dark, which is an anthology series that last month we reviewed Good Boy.
Yeah.
Has their next chapter in this one. For celebrating Independence Day, the month of July, is a film called Current Occupant about a guy who may or may not be the president.
We don't know.
Who knows?
And neither does he.
That's the key. There's also a film called Archive that is at Redbox. And, of course, The Summer of Keanu continues with the film Constantine. This is based off a graphic novel, correct?
DC comic, yep.
One of the best DC comic movies. I don't know. It's been so long. I tell you what, I don't remember anything about Constantine. Everything I thought I remembered, I realized was from the TV show.
Every time I watch it, I think I didn't give it a good enough shot.
Well, it's streaming
on
Hulu.
But it's been a while, so I'm going to give it another shot.
It's there on Hulu for you to watch yet again, and hopefully remember enough to talk about it.
I have it on disc.
Ooh.
Yeah, that was the last time I was like, maybe I didn't give it
a
shot.
Out.
It's like only $5.
All right, fine. Fair enough. Be there. All right. Well, that's what's going to happen next week. I hope you and Jeff have a wonderful time.
We will.
Try not to get us canceled while I'm gone.
We've only did this once before, and it survived.
This is true. Just barely. There were boycotts. Mm-hmm. I think we'll get past it.
Eh.
Anyways, until that time, I'm Jameson.
And I'm Mike Roth.
Thanks for watching. We'll be right back.